I'm gonna use my loud outdoor voice because I move around a lot when I talk, and we're gonna be bringing birds around and stuff. So if anybody can't hear me, raise a hand or something, and I'll talk a little bit louder yet. So like Dale said, and thanks for the wonderful introduction, Dale. Amy and I are from Open Door Bird Sanctuary. We are located just south of Jacksonport in Door County. We have 34 acres there, and it is a bird sanctuary for all different kinds of birds, but our primary focus there is birds of prey. So we do have a couple of those along for you guys to meet today. You'll get a chance to meet them close up and personal in a little while. But first, before I start doing some teaching and some education on migration and birds and things like that, I want to find out what you guys know. So we're talking about birds today, and that's what our whole Algoma Bird Celebration is about, birds. Birds are different from any other kind of animal. Birds are really special critters, and what makes a bird different from other animals? What makes a bird different from a deer, or a turtle, or a mouse? What do you think?
They can fly.
Yeah, birds can fly. Do all birds fly?
No.
No, all birds don't fly. Ostriches don't fly, little kiwis, penguins. Do all birds have wings? Yeah, they do. All birds have wings, but all birds don't fly. So, you know, flying is a special thing, but are there other animals that fly besides birds?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Yes.
Yes, what kind?
Insects,
yeah, insects are animals, and lots of bugs fly. Bats fly. Yeah, some other ones fly too. So a lot of animals fly. So that's not just particular for birds, but that's a big characteristic of birds in flight, and we'll talk about that when we talk about migration as well. So what else makes a bird special? What makes them different from other animals? Any other guesses? Somebody in the back's got to have an idea. I can't let these little kids ace everybody here. What else? Big kids too, not just little kids. Somebody shout something out. What makes a bird different? I didn't hear that one.
Nucleated red blood cells.
Nucleated red blood cells. There you go. That was next on my list too. Can we dumb it down for the presenter a little bit though?
No.
Feathers.
Great. Okay, feathers. Now, one of the things with feathers that make a bird special, this is one of the largest flight feathers in the world. This is from a Himalayan vulture. This is just one single flight feather. One of the things about feathers in the scientific world, we call a feather a diagnostic. There is only one kind of animal throughout the world that has feathers. So if I'm walking in a land I've never been in before, and there's all kinds of strange animals around me, and I walk up and I see an animal sitting there with a feather sticking out, I may not know what that animal is, but I know that that animal is a bird, because only birds have feathers. Different kinds of bird have hair, or different kinds of animals have hair. Some have scales, some have things, you know, reptiles, amphibians, fish. Only birds have feathers. Feathers do a lot of different things for a bird. They give them the ability for flight, which is so important for a bird. And again, you know, this tremendously long flight feather from a Himalayan vulture. Feathers keep a bird warm, they keep a bird dry. In wet weather, they've got special little glands that secrete oil, and they oil their feathers and preen on a very regular basis. Keeps them dry, keeps them warm. Feathers are also used for camouflage. This is the wing from a great horned owl. And everybody thinks about camouflage makes them hide during the day. You know, an owl doesn't want to be seen during the day. They're snoozing up, cuddled up against the trunk of a tree. So camouflage, you see on the outside of the wing of this great horned owl, this camo is called tree camo. It hides them during the day. But these guys come out in late light conditions, low light conditions when they start their hunting.
there still can be quite a bit of light in the sky, early evening, times like that. Well, if this bird was flying over and you see a light sky like this ceiling up here, man, a predator or prey animal is going to spot that right away because it's so big and dark. So when they're flying through the canopy of the trees, going to their hunting areas or going after a prey animal, this would be very visible. That's their tree camel. So what do they have? They have sky camel on the bottoms of their wings. Many, many birds do. So if you look up at this, flying through the trees, the canopy of the trees, you see the light colors, the broken up. So feathers are great for camouflage too. What else makes birds special?
Bones,
yeah. Birds have very, very special bones, very different than ours. They're hollow. They're just like a soda straw because birds are all about being lightweight. So a lot of the attributes you think of with a bird is to be lightweight. So birds lay eggs. You know, they don't want to. I remember when my mom was pregnant with my little brother, I could not imagine her flying anywhere in that condition. So birds lay eggs. You know, it moves that weight from the mom down into the nest so they don't have to carry it around for them. Hollow bones makes them lightweight. What do birds have instead of a big mouthful of teeth? A beak. Yeah, beaks are extremely lightweight. Ounce for ounce, teeth are the heaviest things we have in our body. So birds have a beak which is very lightweight. So hollow bones, laying eggs, lightweight beak and talons, all keeps them very lightweight. So there's a lot of things that make birds very special, very different from all other animals. We've got some kind of special birds along with us. We have birds of prey, predators. Does anybody know what a predator is? What do you think? Yeah, a predator, a bird of prey, is a bird that hunts other animals, any other predators. So when we think of birds of prey, we think of hawks and eagles and falcons, birds like that. Those are, you know, they're hunters. So is some of the birds we see in our yards every day, a cardinal, is that a bird of prey?
No.
How about little chickadee? Little chickadee a bird of prey? Nah. How about a robin? Is that a bird of prey? Oh, I see heads going in two different directions now. I see some going like this and some like this. What do robins do all summer? What do they eat?
Worms.
They eat other animals. They're hunters. Robins are hunters. So they're not a bird of prey like we would think a traditional bird of prey, like a falcon or like an eagle or a hawk. They are still a bird of prey. They're a hunter. The type of birds we have along today are called raptors. And the difference between them and a robin, how does a robin catch its food? With its beak. Yeah. How does a great blue heron catch frogs and fish and things like that? With its beak. How does a woodpecker go hunting? With its beak. Birds of prey, the raptors, they hunt with their feet. And that's where they get their name, raptor. So that's what we have along today. We're going to talk a little bit about migration, though, first. Now, this is a great time of year to be in Wisconsin, to be in a lot of areas. Normally, I would say it's warm and sunny out, but I can't say that today, although we do have a little bit of sunshine. But this is springtime in Wisconsin. We're starting to get a lot of birds that are migrating through this area. A lot of birds that we haven't seen all winter long, and migration in the type that birds do is very, very unique in the animal kingdom. We see migrations of some animals from mountainous areas down into lowland areas, elk and animals like that, where they'll follow food resources a little bit down into a little more comfortable areas. Birds migrate great, great long distances. One of the record holders for migration is called a shearwater. It's very similar to what we would know as a seagull. They're an ocean-going, seagull-like bird. Those shearwaters can migrate on a round trip, migration, 17,000 miles. It's amazing how far they can go. Even little birds like our hummingbirds, you know, here in Wisconsin. We get the ruby-throated hummingbirds every year coming up here in the summertime, all the way up as far north as north southern Canada. Those little hummingbirds, when they migrate, they start usually in late August, early September. They can fly about 20 miles a day on a good day. So they have to get a good early start. Some of those birds, like the shearwaters, some of the other ones can fly 500 miles in a day. Little hummingbirds can't do that. Their wing beats go about anywhere between 20 and 80 beats per second when they are migrating. So that's a lot of wing beats to get yourself going. And they can go about 20 miles a day. So they start earlier in the year. They'll go down as far south as Mexico and Central America. Some of them even crossing the Gulf of Mexico. So you get some of those eastern hummingbirds, instead of going all the way around through Texas, they will fly nonstop across the Gulf of Mexico to get to Mexico. Just an amazing thing. They will put on about 40% additional body weight than their normal summer body weight before they start their migration. So in a little hummingbird, you don't think of that as being a whole lot of weight. But if you put that in relative to me, I weigh close to 200 pounds. If I added an extra 40%, I'd add 80 pounds before I went on a hike. So that's a lot of weight that they put on. Reasons that birds migrate, it varies. Usually there's a food resource tied to it one way or another. When birds migrate, they're leaving a wintering or a summering area because the food resources go away. Here in Wisconsin, you know what happens? We get frost in the ground, all the little bugs and insects die, or they go underground, they hibernate. Our flowers are buried in snow. The plants are done producing fruit and things like that. So there's not a lot of food resources for a lot of birds here in Wisconsin. They go south for food resources. But a bird like a robin, everybody thinks, okay, robins all migrate. It's not because of the cold, it's primarily food resources for them. We do have a number of local resident robins that stay in Door County here in Algoma, along the lakeshores primarily. Robins will stay all year long. They can tolerate the cold temperatures, but it is very challenging for them to find food in the wintertime. So a lot of times that's why they'll head south. One of the great questions I hear a lot about migration is, you know, we put hummingbird feeders out every year. What time should I bring those hummingbird feeders in? I don't want the hummingbirds to stay too long. I want them to migrate. Well, bird migration, generally, there's a couple different theories about it, but what's mostly agreed on is that it's photoperiods of light that trigger migration in birds. So the length of daylight. As that starts to shorten in the fall, that's the trigger for these birds to start migrating. And the hummingbirds are no different. And usually what I tell people is, imagine you've planned to go on a trip for 6 months. You're leaving on September 23rd at 7 p.m. You're hopping on that airplane and you're going to go on a trip that you've been looking forward to for 6 months. You've been packing, you've been preparing, you've been getting all ready to go. You're walking through the airport, you look at your watch and you're like, oh, my flight leaves in 15 minutes. I've got to be on that plane at 7 o'clock. And all of a sudden you see a little sign that says, hey, free hamburger, 7:15. Are you going to stop and miss your flight to go to this wonderful destination you've been planning for months to get one free hamburger? Probably not. So the hummingbirds are the same way, and the birds that visit our feeders are the same way. They're going to go regardless. Don't have to worry about it. So, I think it's about time we got out some birds. What do you guys think?
Yeah.
All right, very good. So, I'm going to have Amy get out our first bird. We are going to start with a non-migratory bird. This bird is one of our residents that you will see here in the Algoma area, Suwannee County, Door County, all throughout Wisconsin and the upper Midwest. This is a nocturnal bird, and it's a raptor. Anybody have an idea what kind of bird it might be if it's nocturnal? Not an eagle. Eagles sleep during the day. What do you think? A owl. Yeah, Amy's going to get out an owl. So when the bird comes out of its travel carrier, it'll kind of settle in a little bit, might flap its wings a little bit, stretch out after a long trip down to North County. So We ask that if you're welcome to take pictures, and Amy will be walking around with the owl. You're welcome to take pictures. Please don't stand up or reach out for the owl. They're used to us and comfortable with us handling, but not comfortable with strangers touching. They're not pets. They are wild animals. The birds that we're caring for at Open Door Bird Sanctuary are all birds that have been injured in one way or another in the wild, all wild birds. Once they've been through rehabilitation, an avian veterinarian has taken a look at them, given them a full exam, and the ones that are at our sanctuary are ones that were deemed unreleasable. Due to their injuries, they cannot survive on their own in the wild. So when you look at a bird of prey, they're hunters. They need all the speed, all the stealth, all the vision, hearing, all of the tools that they would normally have to be able to survive in the wild. Songbirds, they can be injured sometimes. I've had birds by my bird feeders with one crooked leg and a wing that's over here and one eye that's kind of funky, and they've been there for 2 years. You know, they can survive fine, but a bird of prey can't survive with those kind of injuries in the wild. But they can lead a very good, long, healthy life, and that's why they're with us. Well, here we are. I noticed all of a sudden all the eyes left me and went somewhere else. So this is Radar. And Radar is a barred owl. Barred owls are very common here in Wisconsin, and I will tell you a little bit about Radar's story. Radar is the victim of a car strike. We believe that she did not get hit by the car, she hit the car. There is no broken bones or anything like that in Radar, but the impact of striking the side of that car, probably when she was going after prey running across the road, the impact of that gave her detached retinas. Very similar to what a boxer's ailment from getting punched in the head all the time. So she has vision problems. She can see, but we believe just more in shadows and profiles and things like that. So she would not be able to properly hunt in the wild and not be able to survive. Other than that, I'd be careful. Other than that, she is a very, very healthy bird. We do not know how old Radar is, because Radar came in to Open Door Bird Sanctuary as an adult. And once they, you know, work their way out of their juvenile age, when they have juvenile plumage, there's no way to tell how old they are. We could cut her in half and count the rings, but we don't want to do that.
What's that one?
Yeah. Yep. So Amy, Radar looks pretty settled in. Amy looks pretty comfortable too. So she's going to walk around and let you guys see Radar a little bit closer.
Oh, shoot!
And you will see that Radar has little anklets, little leather anklets, almost like wearing a wristwatch on your wrist around her legs. And then she has a little lead that is attached to Amy's glove, so that if she's wherever out somewhere, Radar gets scared or startled by something, if she would happen to take off, she wouldn't know how to find her way back again. So this really keeps her safe. People think that we wear those falconry gloves to protect ourselves, because one of the things that raptors have, birds of prey have, is those amazingly strong, powerful talons. So yes, we wear those gloves to protect our soft little human hands, but really what those gloves are for is that's a comfort zone for those birds. They know that when they're on a glove, they have never been injured. They've never been hurt. They get fed when they're on the glove. Only good things happen to them when they're on that glove. So that's kind of cool for them. Just like when we were little kids and we played tag, there was always something that, if you were there, all right, nothing can get me now, this is cool. And that's what those gloves are for these birds. That's kind of their cool as well. So again, Radar is a barred owl, not a barn owl, but a barred owl, B-A-R-R-E-D. They're a pretty cool bird. One of the birds that you don't see in the wild a lot, although they are very, very common all throughout their territories here in Wisconsin, you don't see them a lot because they don't frequent areas where people live. Not uncommon to see a great horned owl. We see screech owls in the wild sometimes, but barred owls we don't see a lot. They like to live in wetlands. They're really our swamp dwellers. We think of owls and they're all mouse catchers and things like that. Barred owls, their favorite food is anything slimy. So barred owls love to eat frogs and salamanders, things that frequent those wetland areas where they like to live. They will even go into shallow water and take small tadpoles, little fish, things like that from the very shallowest water. One of the only owls that's known to do that, to actually actively hunt for small animals in the water. So very, very cool, unique behavior that these barred owls have. And we'll see those big dark eyes that radar has. That's a sign that that is a bird that hunts in the deepest, darkest part of the night. When you look at photographs of other owls, and I think, yeah, you might be able to see this. This is one of the owls we have at the sanctuary, a very close cousin to a great horned owl. See the colored irises? Just like our eyes, when you see an owl that has eyes like this, that means that that bird hunts at dawn and dusk. When you see an owl that has these amazing deep dark eyes like radar does, and there's only a few owls that have eyes like that, that means that they hunt in the dead of night. So they don't go out hunting till midnight, 1, 2 in the morning. We suspect the main reason that they do that is to not get preyed on by great horned owls. So even though you are kind of at the top of the food chain as a predator like that, you can still be somewhere in the middle. You know, you can always fall prey to another animal, and if a great horned owl came across a barred owl like this and thought it could catch it, it would be a great snack. So some other cool owl facts. Radar got her name because of that really cool radar-looking dish that is her face. And what that does is that focuses sound. That is what we think of as ears. Now, if I told you guys to all point at your ears, where would you point? You'd point at these big things hanging off the side of your head. That's not our ears. These are just funnels that make sound go into our ears. Our ears are inside of our head. These are just big fleshy funnels, and I'll bet it would be really hard to fly with these. So owls don't have that, but they still need a way to funnel the sound. Their ears are right behind their eyes, just like our ears are in our head, and there's a big long slit in the side of their head, which goes into their inner ear where they hear. But they need something to funnel all that sound to those little slits in the side of their head. So instead of these big goofy things, they have that cool facial disc of feathers. They can actually turn just those feathers and move them to really focus the sound. Very cool. So that's something neat. That's where Radar got her name. Another cool thing is if you ever get a chance or you can look online, something like that, take a look at an owl skull. Look at a picture of an owl skull. One thing that's really neat, when we see something, we have three-dimensional sight. I can look out at you guys and I could probably throw a ball or a wad of paper at you and hit you right in the chest. I know exactly how far away you are. If you made a little clapping sound when I had my eyes closed, and I tried to hit you with that same little wad of paper, heck knows where it'd fly. I know what direction you are, but I don't know how far away you are just from hearing. If you look at an owl's skull, they have one ear canal that's down here, and they have one ear canal that's up here. Good thing they have good vision, because they look really goofy wearing glasses. But with those two different ear canals in different positions, sound travels in waves like this. So when that sound gets to an owl, it's always going to hit one ear before the other ear. And that gives them three-dimensional hearing. An owl's ears are so good, and their hearing is so good, that there can be a mouse down under the snow or down in the leaf litter in the forest floor. They can be sitting on their branch, hear that mouse, know exactly how far away that mouse is. They can fly down, capture that mouse in their talons, and never have seen it. That's how good and how three-dimensional their hearing is. Everything on these birds is all set up for their hunting style, for the way they feed themselves. And so those adaptations, hunting at night, having amazing night vision, having amazing hearing, silent flight, those things are what really, really it makes these owls specials and makes them adapted to their nighttime lifestyle. So Amy would like to put radar in and get Coco out. So we have one owl that is a native to here in this area, and that's radar. We've got another bird along too, that is another owl, and she is actually a migratory owl, so we can get back into the migration a little bit. Next owl that's going to come out to visit you guys is the smallest owl that we have here in Wisconsin. So Amy, when she gets Coco out, she's definitely going to have to walk around with her a little bit, because Coco's about that big. Some of the things, when you watch these birds and when you see them come out, observe their motions and observe how they do it. Now with a bird like Coco or a bird like Radar that you just saw, when you saw her looking around, what did she do to look different directions? What did she do? She turned her head all the time. So when we look around, I can look all over the room and never move my head. I can move my eyes around in my head. I've got muscle structure around my eyeballs that move my eyes up and down and side to side. Owls do not have that. Owls cannot move their eyes in their head. So to compensate for that, their eyes are too big. There's no room there for muscles. So to compensate for that, owls have amazingly flexible necks. So here's your little assignment you're going to have right now. Everybody, kind of bend down a little bit and put your hand on the back of your neck. Everybody do that. Feel those little bumps on the back of your neck? Those are neck vertebrae, part of our spine. They're neck vertebrae. We all have 7 of those. All mammals do. So I don't care if you're a giraffe, or if you're a whale, or a little mouse, or a shrew, or a dog, or a deer, if you're a mammal, you have 7 of those neck bones in your neck, and that gives us flexibility to move our head around. An owl has twice as many vertebrae in his neck. How many is that?
14!
Yeah, an owl has 14 vertebrae in their neck. That's what gives them the ability to move their head so far. How far can an owl turn its head around? Any guesses? What do you think?
360.
360. Any other guesses?
270.
270. I got 3/4. I got all the way. How far do you think?
180 degrees.
180. Half of a circle. Well, you're slightly correct. An owl could turn their head all the way around once in their lifetime. That would be the last thing they ever did. An owl can turn their head 270 degrees, so you are spot on, 3/4 of the way around. So if I'm an owl and I'm standing here watching a little mouse, and that mouse starts moving around me clockwise, I can turn my head, I can watch it over here, I can keep turning my head, I can watch it behind me, I can keep turning my head and watch that little mouse go all the way over here, all in the same direction. If the mouse keeps going, I have to quick turn back around and then start this way and start following it again. So owls move their head so fast on a swivel and so mechanically, it looks like they have turned their head all the way around. They can go 3/4 of the way around. They've got very special veins and arteries that go through their neck that don't get pinched when they turn so far. So it's a very, very special configuration of bones and arteries and all the things they have to allow them to turn their head so far around. Coming? Somebody was taking a nap in her carrier. So some of the other special things about owls, that cool ability to move their head around, because they are hunters at nighttime, their eyes are very different than ours. Does anybody know what those two things are in our eyes that allow us to see either light or color? Anybody remember from biology class in high school what those two things were?
Oh, you're looking at me?
Anybody.
Okay, rods and cones.
Yes, rods and cones. So there are two things in our eyes, rods and cones, that give us the ability to either see light or give us the ability to see color. humans are very balanced in that. We have very good color range, so we have a lot of cones. We have very good vision, not real good night vision, but we have pretty good light receptors. We have a very good balance of rods and cones. And the way I always remember, somebody told me this at one of the programs, because I always used to forget which was rods and which was cones. I always think of orange highway cones, the traffic cones being orange. So those are the color receptors. Oh, yes.
Wait till she turns around.
So these guys, the little owls, have very, very few cones in their eyes for color reception. They don't see color very well at all. They have almost all rods in their eyes, which helps them to see in low light condition. A little owl, like Coco, could see a mouse by the light of a candle from about a football field away. The light of one candle.
He's warm. Yeah, okay. Outside.
Yep, don't reach out to the birds because they're just not used to that. That's like a big predator. Coco was also the victim of a car strike. So she has some damage to her left wing as she comes around. She's partially flighted. She can fly very short distances, but not real well. Now, this is one of the birds we talked about as being a migratory species. So very little is known about saw-whet migration. They started doing some studies in the 90s with banding saw-whet owls, a lot of them here in Wisconsin, because they're very secretive. They do not like to live in close proximity with people. They love the big, deep, very traditional forest-like settings. They are very nocturnal. So this is a bird that, you know, you don't see the normal migration. Man, when robins come through, I see them. When turkey vultures come back in the spring, you see them. Geese, all those different birds. You know, the owls, a migrating owl is not one you would normally see because they travel at night. They've been doing a lot of mist netting on these guys. They know that some saw-whet owls do migrate. Some stay in their territories and protect the territory, because the territory for a bird of prey is very valuable. But when they migrate, it's generally short distance, and they do little leapfrog migrations. So saw-whet owls from extreme northern Wisconsin or southern Canada will probably migrate to central or southern Wisconsin. That's as far as they go. And saw-whet owls from southern Wisconsin may migrate down into central or southern Illinois. So it's kind of a little leapfrog that they do. But they're still doing a lot of studies. They band every year, 1,000 to 2,000 saw-whet owls get banded. And so they're really starting to learn now some of the migrational patterns of these little guys. Don't walk up, please don't walk up behind the birds. They really are not comfortable with people walking up behind them. So if you would like to have a picture or something, just kind of raise your hand and Amy will come close to you with the bird so you get a chance to see it. So like I said, Coco is the smallest owl that we have here in Wisconsin. One of the things that their favorite foods, now in the springtime when they have young, they are very good mousers. So they will catch mice because they need a very high food supply for feeding their young. Most of the time, they are not so much a carnivore, they are an insectivore. So think of those big moths you see flying around in the deep dark of night. That's a great meal for a tiny little bird like this. Saw-whet owl only weighs about 3 ounces. So there's not a whole lot of bird underneath those feathers. Very, very small bird. Great insectivores. They are cavity nesters, so saw-whet owls nest in hollow trees, in hollowed out logs, things like that. Their eggs are very, very tiny, as you might imagine. They will lay 2 to 4 of them. One of the unique things about owls is when an owl lays an egg in the nest, they start incubating that egg right away. And they will lay one every day, sometimes every other day, and they start incubating them right away. So at the beginning, an owl hatches. And then a couple days later, another owl hatches. And a couple days later, if they have 4 eggs, there might be 10, 11 days in between when the very first owl hatches and the last owl hatches. Unfortunately for that last owl, he may become food for the first owl that was hatched. 8 to 10 days in the life of a baby bird is a long, long time. Those birds grow so fast that those last ones born could very well become food for the first ones born. Barn owls, that's very common. Barn owls can lay 10 to 12 eggs. So you can have the first barn owl that hatches could be 3 weeks older than the last one that hatches. They're half grown already. That last one hatches, he's just going to be a snack. So like I said, Cocoa, smallest owl we have here. We have some other very small owls here in Wisconsin and North County, Kewaunee, all the areas around here. The screech owl, tiny, tiny little owls, but they're about twice the size of a little saw-whet owl. Some of the other things that are cool about owls, we have talked about the vision, we talked about the wonderful movement of the neck. One of the things you'll see, and you'll notice a big difference between a bird like this and when I get the next bird out, the turkey vulture, you look at the feathers on these birds, and right down to the tips of their toes, right almost to the tip of their beak, you will see them covered with feathers. That's for silent flight. And one of the things, one of the things that we talk about with that silent flight is, when owls fly, there's virtually no sound, but they have to have a lot of special adaptations to be able to do that. One of those adaptations is their feather covering. It covers their beak. Any hard surface that an owl has gets covered by feathers. Anything that moves, you can go back in. Anything that moves through the air that has a hard surface makes noise. Is our rope in the... Okay, and I can give you a little demonstration. Where is it? Well, there it is. Yes, please. So, this is just a garden variety piece of cotton rope. Nothing special about it at all. I gotta move out where I got some room here. So, now you would think that this end of the rope is not a hard surface. It's really not. It's pretty soft to the touch and everything, but if I take this rope, make sure I'm clear here, and I spin it, whoosh. Everybody hear the noises that makes? So that's just a soft thing moving through the air quickly. But owl's feathers, and you can come up and see some owl feathers after the program, owl's feathers have all special little ridges on the front edge of their flight feathers. Their hard surfaces are all covered with soft things. So an owl, here's the exact same piece of rope, just the other end of it. But what we've done is we've added all these little fuzzy bits on there. That's like owl feathers. Same piece of rope. I'm going to spin this as hard as I can. Not a sound. Same piece of rope. So that's where owls get that silent flight. Everything on them is covered up with soft surfaces, which makes them fly very silently. All right.
A question about owls.
Oh, yes.
What do the crows have against owls? Like, you'll see an owl and then, like, 30 crows.
Yep. Great question. Now, he wanted to know what crows have against owls. You know, and that's a very common thing to see. A great horned owl, a barred owl is roosting up in a big pine tree just minding their own business, and a crow finds it. And they call all the other crows over, and it's like, all right, time to get this owl. Owls are predators, crows are prey. And so you'll see that in the bird world all the time. Owls are very slow, methodical flyers. During the daytime, they're not, you know, they're not going to be going out hunting or anything. Crows compared to an owl are very aerodynamic. They can fly, they can turn, they're faster, they're very aerodynamic. It'd be like a big bomber plane compared to a little fighter plane. Man, that fighter plane can go all over. They want to harass that owl and get that owl out of their territory because they know that that owl's a predator. You will see the same thing if you have a crow or a raven sitting there and some blackbirds find it. Red-winged blackbirds, very common for mobbing, and that's what that behavior is called. It's called mobbing. they know that that crow might find their nest and steal their young out and eat them, or steal the eggs out and eat the eggs. So those blackbirds will get together, same thing. Now the crow is the big bomber, and the blackbirds are the little fighter planes. And they can fly and go all over and really harass them and just chase them out of the area. You'll see that with big hawks and little hawks. You'll see that in all different ways. Usually, though, if they end up on the ground, the bigger bird has a distinct advantage over the smaller one then. But when they're in midair, the advantage really goes to the small bird. All right, I'm going to get our next visitor out. I see we're getting down there on time. So this bird is another... this bird is a migratory bird. This particular one doesn't, because she lives with us at the sanctuary. Her name is Amber. She is a turkey vulture. And turkey vultures are one of the birds that migrate for a couple different reasons. One is food resources, because they are scavengers, and in the wintertime, scavenging for food can be pretty challenging in Wisconsin, because everything is snow-covered. The other thing is, they are not really well adapted to cold temperatures. Turkey vultures can get very prone to frostbite, and I feel really bad for a lot of the vultures that are up here now that have come up. But now we're getting this very, very cold weather, so food is hard to find, very challenging staying warm. Can be really tough, and vultures are prone to frostbite in their feet. They do regulate their body temperatures. It's very hard to do in this time of year. In the summertime or springtime when there's warm sun, it's not so bad.
Hi, Julie. Hey, my pup. How are you? Come on, I'll say.
Here is Amber. I better get off of this carpet. So this is Amber. Amber is a female turkey vulture. And she is very standard, very typical in size for a vulture. Everybody says, geez, I thought they were a lot bigger. She's got close to a 6-foot wingspan, which is about the same as my wingspan if I spread my arms out full size. So, you know, she is average size for a turkey vulture, but very, very unique. She is not a true raptor. She is called a bird of prey, but she is not a raptor. If you look at her feet that she has, she does have long, long nails on there, but she doesn't have the grabbing kind of feet. There's those big wings. Big stretch. So they don't have grabbing or grasping feet like most raptors do. These guys were actually descended from the stork family. So all of our vultures here in the New World came from the stork family. That's their ancestors. If you look at the Old World vultures, like the European and the African vultures, all of those, they're a different type of vulture. They've actually descended from hawks and eagles. So they still have the grippy feet, very different type of bird, although they look almost exactly the same. Everybody thinks that vultures are so ugly, but they're really, really not. Go show off your big wings. Amber is going to be 3 years old this year, so she's just a youngster. Now, when you look at her and say, wow, what injury could she have had? Hers is not physical, it's psychological. She very unfortunately is in very good physical health. She was taken from the nest as a young bird. Somebody claimed to have found her abandoned, and they tried to raise her. She became imprinted on people and never learn how to associate with other birds, with other vultures. One of the things about vultures is it's not uncommon for vulture parents only to raise young every other year. It takes a long time for a vulture to learn how to be a vulture. So they spend a lot of time with their parents. There's a big stretch. Are you settling in? They spend a lot of time with their parents socializing. You know, when you see vultures, they're always in groups. They have a very strong social dynamic, and that doesn't come instinctually. You have to learn how to be a vulture. So in Amber's case, she missed out on all that learning, and she only learned how to associate with the one or two people that she saw. Then they tried to release her back into the wild, and she wouldn't go away. She wasn't able to join the other vultures. She wasn't able to eat. She wasn't able to feed herself. She was used to having it all given to her, and nobody taught her how to do that. She did end up at a rehabilitation center. She was dropped off at the doorstep of a rehabilitation center. They tried for a long time introducing her to other vultures, hoping that she could then pick up some of those social skills and social interactions to learn how to be a vulture. There are those big wings. There's a good view of them. What happened with Amber was she just got beat up by the other vultures. She didn't know how to understand when they would give her body language and give her communications like, hey, you're in my area, or that piece of food is mine, you're a little kid, you wait till I'm done eating, then you can come eat some. She didn't understand all of that. And so she got beat up pretty bad. So in the wild, she would not be able to survive with other vultures. These guys are great migrators. Our vultures here in Wisconsin, and they'll move in the summertime, they'll be all the way up into southern Canada now. These guys migrate using geographical features. So when I remember when I was a kid, it was rare, and I lived in southern Wisconsin, it was rare to see a vulture. We just didn't see them when I was a kid. But they keep going farther and farther and farther and farther north all the time. You know, all the way up into southern Canada now is where they will nest and have residents up there. They suspect it's because of our modern freeway systems. Because what that does for a migrating bird like a turkey vulture is that follows landmarks to migrate. It gives them a great landmark. Boy, you can take Highway 94 and go all the way up to Eau Claire. You know, you can take other roads and just follow those roadways. Well, so that's one thing. It gives you a great visual. You know, the shoreline of Lake Michigan, north and south. If you're headed north, man, that's a great way to migrate. Highways are a great way too. But secondary to that, for a vulture, that's a buffet. You know, think of what vultures eat. They eat dead stuff. So all along the highway system, all of those animals, the roadkill animals, they not only have a great migratory route that they can cover fast, you know, distances, long distances in a quick way, they also have food stops all the way along the way of that highway system. So they really suspect that that's one of the big booms in the migration farther northward for these turkey vultures is the modern freeway system. And they will migrate southern vultures, and turkey vultures are the most widespread vulture in all the world. They go all the way from southern and central Canada down to the very, very, very tip of South America, all the way down to Tierra del Fuego. And it's the same turkey vulture all throughout. So the southern ones down in South America, they don't migrate, they just stay there all year round. But our northern vultures, they do migrate. So a bird like Amber, they will go down south of the snow cover. Sometimes they'll go as far south as Texas, Arizona, you know, along the coast and that. A lot of times they'll just stay south of the snow cover. So if it's snowy all the way down to southern Illinois and Kentucky, areas like that, it might be as far as they go, a little bit past that. If it's a very warm winter, they don't need to migrate as far. So it's just wherever their food resources are and wherever the conditions are a little bit better for them to live. These guys are not, remember I said that hummingbird, their little wings might go 80 times a second when they're migrating? A vulture can fly for 3 or 4 hours and never flap their wings once. Not once. These guys are the ultimate birds for soaring. They ride thermals. They do different types of soaring to cover great distances without ever flapping their wings. And one of the reasons that they have evolved to have the ability to do that is, are these guys really predators? Are they hunters? Vultures? Not really. They eat dead stuff. You know, they're the cleaner-uppers of the world. So they don't know when their next meal is going to be. If I'm an owl and I get hungry, and I say, you know what, I'm really hungry, I'm going to go catch some food and eat it. A vulture can't do that. You know, they can't sit in a tree and wait for a dead animal to walk by. Ain't going to happen. You know, so they have to go out find their food. They don't know when their next meal is going to be. So the longer they can conserve energy till they find that next food, and the more territory, the more ground they can cover searching for food by expending very little energy, the better it is for them. So they have managed to have this amazing flight style. When you look up in the sky, and now we are starting to see vultures here in this area, when you look up and you see these big birds soaring over, you think, is that an eagle? Is that a hawk? You know, what is that great big bird flying over here? The best way to identify if it's a vulture or not is to look at the shape that they're holding their wings. When you see an eagle fly over or a hawk or some of those other very large birds, their wings are straight out when they're gliding and riding wind currents and things like that. A vulture has their wings in a V shape. So their wings are up like this. They call that a dihedral. So we always say, here's the sign for a vulture right there. When you see a vulture, that's the sign to make. You know that that's a vulture. Their wings are up in the air like this. They ride in a V shape. So very easy to identify in flight. Everybody says, why did they got that bald head? One of the reasons is for their lifestyle, the way that they eat. Like I said, these birds are all, there's a big stretch. Oh, one wing and one foot. They always stretch one side at a time. A lot of that adaptation is for the way that they eat. They, you know, dive into a carcass. They don't like rotted food. Everybody thinks that vultures will eat just anything, and they kind of can. My wife is a veterinary student right now, and I learned that the contents of the stomach acid in a vulture, their acidic number is 1, pure acid. So they can eat pretty much anything. They like fresh food. You know, we like well-hung steaks. These guys, if they wouldn't have to have them, they wouldn't want them. They want their meat very fresh. But usually to get to that fresh meat that they have access to on a carcass, they have to go way inside to where it's been refrigerated, where it's been protected inside that carcass. So this part of their body is very difficult for them to clean up on their head. So that's one of the reasons for really having a lack of feathers up on the head. Another reason is temperature regulation. Remember I said that these birds will regulate their temperatures at night, again, to conserve energy. They lower their body temperature when they roost at night. In the morning, you'll very often see vultures with their wings spread wide open, just sitting on a tree branch, a fence post, on a hillside, just absorbing the sun. That raises their body temperature again, also gets rid of parasites from their feathers and things, and that's what helps them prepare for the day. They'll raise their body temperature back up. That lack of feathers on their head helps them adjust their body temperature quite well. Just like whether we were wearing a knit cap in the wintertime or take it off to cool off a little bit. So it helps them regulate that. So I see that our time is pretty much done here. I would like to thank all you guys very much for coming out. There is going to be a lunch break between now and 12:45 when the next program begins. We're going to take our time and just slowly pack up and things like that. Anybody that's got questions, once I get Amber put away, please come up and ask your questions. If you enjoyed our bird program here today, tell everybody about Open Door Bird Sanctuary. We are a private, nonprofit group. We are still, to this point, we're 100% volunteer run. So all of the money that we raise, everything goes into our bird care, not for salaries, not for trips to the Bahamas, nothing like that. It all goes into bird care and development of the sanctuary. We are, for the first time on a regular basis, going to be open to the public this summer. June, July, and August, every other weekend, the second and fourth weekends of June, July, and August, we're going to be open to the public Saturday and Sunday. noon to 4, and we're going to do a multi-raptor bird show at 1 o'clock at each of our open days. Yes?
So obviously you are licensed for raptors because, so if we find an injured bird, is somebody going to answer your line? Sometimes we're closer to you than to the sanctuary in Green Bay.
That's a good question. We are licensed for the care of birds of prey, but not for rehabilitation. Because one of the big things, we do have rehab on our sites as far as coming up in the future. We need a clinic building for that, and we need full-time staff for that. So we don't want to get ahead of ourselves and put the chicken ahead of the egg, so to speak. So we are not yet set up for rehabilitation. The closest licensed rehabilitator for injured wildlife is still Bay Beach in Green Bay. We can certainly help if somebody's in the Door County area, finds an injured bird. We can guide you, we can help you. I have on my own time taken a few birds down that people weren't able to get to Green Bay. I've packed them up and taken a half a day off of work and taken them down there myself just to make sure they get into good care. But we are not licensed or set up for that at this time. I don't want to kiss. I don't like vulture business. So like I said, we've got, Amy's got some free passes as well for children to come out to the sanctuary this summer. So if you'd like to stop up by Amy, we'll hand these free passes out to any kids that want to come over, and you can get into the sanctuary this summer for free. Like I said, sign up for our email list if you would like to, and that's about it. I'll get Amber put away, and we'll be here to answer questions.